two players have been eliminated, and it's now time to go into the third quarterfinal of the evening. And like I mentioned before the break, we will be playing the next two quarterfinals on this stage. The last one is Pult versus TLO. For now, it's time for Jaedong versus Hydra. Joining me on the desk is In Control and the number one StarCraft 2 streamer God, on Twitch.
Can you please let it go?
It is Rotterdam08, everybody.
Well, Sean, I could continue streaming if I could just see another tutorial of yours. My PVT is a little rusty these days.
I know you do need some help.
Yes.
I might be able to help you out. You've been staying in the Netherlands recently. Yeah. I can make a trip over and tell you how to get bronze to Masters.
I love it, Sean. Love it. Can't wait.
Good to have Kev up here as always. But let's get serious now. Jaedong, thank you, versus Hydra. A big match here. Let's first of all talk about Hydra.
He has shown nothing but top-notch play. Yesterday he laid dormant. I can only imagine he was playing like 8 games of StarCraft at once, probably. And he just smashed his group, absolutely obliterated. I mean, we just saw Bunny tear up Stardust, and then day 2 he looked amazing as well. Let's not forget, Bunny was put in kind of a perilous situation because he faced the monster that is Hydra. And it's interesting too, because we look at a lot of these guys. I was just flabbergasted by the stat that Lilbo's only dropped one map since round of 32. Well, that one map was too Hydra, who's he's just all over the place. He beats everyone, even if it's just one map. But
he's been so dominant.
Hey, those
dominant.
Are In Control stats here.
He's been so dominant this year, Roddy. I mean, he's reached 3 finals within the WCS circuit. One of them, of course, being the Premier League last season. And he continues to just perform better and better, more so than he's ever done in his entire career, until we go back to when he was on top in Brood War. What is the key to success? What changed for him over these last 6 months?
I mean, it's a little bit of everything. I do feel in general he's a lot more happy in life right now. Ever since he joined Root, some people were like, oh, it's actually a little bit of a shame that such an amazing player like Hydra is going to America. But the guy's loving it, man. He's loving life. I think Jeff brought it up as well. He's not a Korean that sits in his corner and doesn't communicate with the rest of the house. I visited him once in Northern California, and he was having a great time. He's like, when are we going out for burgers and stuff? You know, he's just loving it. Plays every single online tournament he can participate in. He's so relaxed, he's so good, and his skill, it did not drop. If anything, it just got so much higher. And I feel right now, of course, he has so much more opportunity as well to shine. He may have always been this good, but back then he had 1 or 2 chances, and he had to go up against all those other top-notch Koreans. Right now, it's obviously a slightly easier field for him. And I mean, he's just taking full advantage of that. He's like, hey man, I've seen what the other Koreans have done in the previous years. I'm going to rack in some cash as well, and he's doing a great job of that.
And he really has been. I mean, he was picked by a lot of the guys here that are casting this event as the favorite over Pult, over the Jaedong, over the Bunny, and that's staying true, and he's really showing it as well.
Absolutely. We only have that first day to go off of, but if that first day is anything to go off of, he's in form. And I have to agree with everything Kevin's saying too. Like, there's something to be said for kind of that Kespa work ethic that he comes from, where they were just monsters of training. But if you give them a little bit of freedom and happiness, and I'm not talking too much down, but what I mean is, like, to put them in an environment where they can kind of also be okay with themselves and practice and work that hard, we've seen some scary results. There's been some really good players.
Well, you know, another guy who has had scary results in the past, let's switch our focus now to the tyrant himself, Jaedong. 2013 BlizzCon finalist, and he continued to put in a lot of results in 2014. And even though 2013 was definitely the year that stood out the most for him in StarCraft 2, 2014 was not bad by no means. It was still very, very impressive. 2015 has been bad simply because he hasn't done anything yet. He's been on holiday, he's been on vacation, as you said, he's been taking a bit of a break, but he's finally back to the circuit, he's back playing. And so far, he hasn't looked unimpressive in this tournament, Jeff.
No, I think the blemish is definitely his series against Stardust, where, again, it was 2 very exciting games. For us fans, it made for an awesome series. But if you're watching closely from a Jaedong perspective, it's 2 games that he really should have closed out, wasn't able to, and lost. And I think that's something that's been nagging him. For a while, he was kind of known as the second-place finisher as well, something that Hydra's kind of doing right now, where, again, closing out is really difficult for him. So can he do it against Hydra? Hydra's the guy that is the hype. He's probably the favorite, if not Pult. Well, it's gonna have to be an amazing performance. He does get ZvZ, which is probably in his wheelhouse, but not nearly as much as it used to be. It used to be like, well, JVZ, Jaedong will beat any other Zerg. Really not the case anymore. Even dropped the map to Betrayus yesterday.
Yeah, Roddy, Jaedong going up against Hydros, he played him a few months back in Gfinity Spring Arena, I think it was. And he lost. He couldn't defeat Hydra. He's got a tall task ahead of him today. He's just outside the top 16 with a good performance here. He starts to push himself closer and closer to the global finals, but this is not going to be easy.
Now, that was one of the very first tournaments he played in, though, and he also played him online in a tournament that I've casted as well. I think Hydra won that encounter too, but that was literally after 3 or 4 months break, and I was actually positively surprised by the level that Jaedong brought. I mean, if I would go to Hawaii 3 months, I come back. Yeah. I'm in Gold League, yeah. Sean. Like, I have to start from scratch again. And Jaedong was still putting up a really good performance, but it wasn't good enough, but he's always been a smart player. He can learn from those mistakes. He can learn from the games in general.
Hydra, at the point when he did play Jaedong, said that that was the scariest point of the tournament, and anything after that was going to be easier. So here is Hydra, rank 9 in the world within the WCS. He is in a good position when it comes to ranking. He's got great stats, and as we've already brought up, is playing brilliant this year.
Hydra is just a phenomenal player in general, but especially in ZvZ. Now, I'm going to quote Letot here. I am no ZvZ expert, but actually, I've casted quite a few of his series, and I've always reached out to Katz, his manager. I was like, hey, what can I expect? And he's like, well, it's very hard to predict him, because Hydra is capable of playing every single style in ZvZ. He doesn't have one go-to style. He learns from the series as well. You want to play a certain style, Hydra can do the exact same thing as you did in game one. He's going to do it in game two, and he's just going to do it better. Of course, being like better in mechanics than Jaedong is going to be difficult, but he is so strong in every department in ZvZ, and mostly his unpredictability.
Yeah, he's going to have to bring that to the table here. Zerg versus Zerg, a classic on Expedition Lost, the favorite Zerg map for all. One thing I noted on the map vetoes, 2 4-player maps were taken out, Inferno Pools, and one more.
Cactus Valley, maybe?
No, the
Iron Fortress?
Iron Fortress, thank you. Two of them have managed to get into the best of 5. Of course, Zerg players who think they're very good will eliminate these 4-player maps to try to push it to 2-player maps where it is a little bit more skill-based. But 2 of them have snuck in. How much can this change the series quite quickly here, Roddy?
I don't think they're going to go too crazy on it. I believe both players are very confident and capable of playing this matchup. I think Hydra is not going to roll the dice. I think he's just going to rely on his mechanics and especially his game knowledge. He makes pushes work that even when your opponent knows it's coming and you're not supposed to attack in that phase in the game, I've seen Hydra on multiple occasions just win, running up ramps and winning in ZvZ. Like, you don't do that. It's supposed to be a boring matchup, Sean.
All right, well, it is time to start the next quarterfinal. The Tyrant goes up against the Season 1 finalist. Only one is coming out of this.
It's time to get into it, Toronto, as we have our Zerg versus Zerg. Moving on into the round of 4, who is going to be victorious, the Tyrant or our second place finisher from the previous season? This is quite the highlight, because for me, both of these players have a brilliant, masterful position here in Zerg versus Zerg. Obviously, JVZ is brilliant, but he goes up against Hydra. Let's get into it. Game number 1 in this best of 5 here. I hope you're awake, Toronto, because this one is going to be a good one. As we have spawning to the bottom left, it is our red Zerg representing Root. It is Hydra. And up to the top right-hand corner, we have our blue Zerg. I know a lot of you guys are behind him out there, representing evil geniuses. It is Jaedong.
So much crowd support there for Jaedong. He's just got so many fans all around the world. And this is going to be a very interesting Zerg vs. Zerg series.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Jaedong, obviously, for a long, long period of time, had second place after second place after second place. It never ended. At the very final end of that particular year where he had those string of results, he got his first place. But was it the first place he really wanted? A lot of people would say that's probably not the case. He is looking always for the big trophy, for the glory, for the very, very tip of the mountain. Here in WCS Season 2, he could achieve that. He could achieve that, but going up against Hydra to start things off, that is quite the mountain to climb if you want to get to the tip.
It really, really is. And you kind of have to look at Hydra and think he's kind of taken over that sort of second place role himself, where he's doing so well at the moment, where Jaedong has done previously. He's been so close to so many championships, but he's also facing that same potential title of the King of Kongs, the King of Second Place. He needs to close that out. And I think coming into this, it's fair to say Hydralisk, he's doing better recently. He's at the top of his game. potentially even a favorite, but Zerg versus Zerg, Jaedong, it's almost definitely going to be a very, very close match.
You're completely right. You're right on the money there, Pig, because we've seen Hydra this year play phenomenally. I mean, nobody can really dispute that. But second place at Gfinity 1, second place at Gfinity 2, second place last season here in WCS. It's gathering to the point where he needs a championship. Placing second is all good and fine. You're getting yourself a lot of money. You're gaining some recognition. But is it the recognition you really want? Is it the place you really want? These players have the hearts of champions. Both of them are Brood War champions. Very few people remember the fact that Hydra won himself an MSL all those years ago. And today, they meet again.
Such a solid Pro League player. There's such long history with both of these players. They've both carried such long, illustrious esports careers, and they are going to be going here head-to-head to see who is the master of the Zerg race.
And we shall find out. Jaedong has had quite a few Zergs to actually dispatch off here in the World Championship Series Season 2 so far. Done well for himself. Some of those games, though, Petraeus put up a good fight. Wasn't enough to defeat Jaedong. Then, now, Jaedong has to go up against Hydra, who has really carved out a place for himself here in the World Championship Series and is fearsome. I can guarantee almost every single player in the top 8 lineup did not want to play Hydra. Out of all the players, I think that most people look at him as the fiercest.
He is an absolutely scary opponent. My personal favorite to do fantastic in this tournament. Interestingly, looking at the build order choices here, Hydra playing a little bit of a safer opening, rushing his spawning pool out after his hatchery, maybe being a little bit worried about the potential for an early spawning pool. Jaedong, on the other hand, looking very unencumbered, taking a faster gas, delaying his spawning pool a little bit, really focusing on getting out a lot of economy and getting that very fast Zergling speed for map control.
Yeah. This is almost the feel-out game for them here in a best of five. It's that one step towards understanding your opponent a little bit better. Obviously, in Zerg versus Zerg, there are a number of options to open up with. And, you know, some of those things can come down to, did I set my Overlord in the correct direction? Thankfully, because this is a two-player spawning map, you can actually do that quite fast. But Jaedong throwing the Baneling Nest down at the back here, whilst not rapidly going up towards his gas. He only had the one in for a while, now throwing back three in. Is there room here for him to be a little bit aggressive?
Really quite a divergence there, and I think against Hydra's defensive queen base play, there definitely is a window to do damage. However, he does come in with the Zergling now, and he does see lots of queens, but he gets past the drones on the ramp. He's going to come into the main base and try to figure out what is going on in here. Notice Hydra starting up his Zergling speed to trick the Zergling, trying to make it look like he actually wants to invest in it. But as soon as this Zergling gets out of range, he cancels it, starts the lair. But Jaedong dancing this Zergling around, he wants to go back in. Oh, and Hydra's cutting off that scouting just before Jaedong could get the information.
Did he see the lair morphing in? He may have seen the lair, actually.
Just going to check that. He barely caught a glimpse of it, actually. So he did verify there was a fast lair starting up.
All right, so that might have given away a little bit there, giving so much confidence in that queen, but it wasn't able to do the business off the creep. Obviously very, very slow to actually deal with that dancing quick Zergling there off the back of it. Third base is going to go down for Jaedong on the other side here. Hydra trying to wall things off at the front, keeping Jaedong a little bit more in the dark, but for all intents and purposes, almost everything has been revealed here to Jaedong.
And both players not really pushing for anything too crazily aggressive here. Both players seem to be really sticking to that zone of I'm comfortable in the Roach game and I'm going to go there. The main area, which we're looking at now, is Jaedong taking that faster third base. He's taking a bit of a later lair, later Roach Warren. He's really getting a few more Zerglings out on the map here. He's going to be trying to take down these rocks. This is a really clever move. Knowing his Roaches are later and he's going to get more drones out. If he can take the rocks down in the middle of the map, it's going to slow down any Roach push from Hydra and that's going to buy him a lot of time.
You're totally right. I mean, with that third hatchery up and running, soon to be, great little move here for him. Obviously, Hydra at the moment doesn't have his third open, even started. That is being spotted by the... Oh, but he's going to take the gold base. Oh, this is quite the move. And those Zerglings, did they even spot the drone moving out towards that?
I don't think they did. I think it's just a Roach push coming their way. I think that's what they believe it is. Trying to come in from behind and cut off that base. Jaedong does have an Overlord,
yeah,
though.
He sees it.
He does see the gold base, so he does know what's going on. And this is something which puts a lot of pressure onto Jaedong. Hydra saying, I'm going to mine a lot more money than you if you don't do something about this. I don't care if you have a faster third, because I'm going to have a gold base. And this puts it into a really interesting position. position.
And in Roach versus Roach, in Zerg versus Zerg, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but gold bases mean a lot because of the way in which Roaches cost a whole lot more minerals than they do gas here, right? He can get out so many to combat just a Roach versus Roach composition.
He will have a complete swell there, and he will have that boost in that mid game. Of course, Defender's advantage is quite strong, but Expedition Lost being a map which is so focused on Roach versus Roach counterattacks, and often we see Burrow movement come in later in the game, it could really pay off in dividends for Hydra. Right now, we see Jaedong still trying to buy himself time. Jaedong not feeling confident fighting just yet, as he does have that worker lead. He is up 54 drones to just the 42 of Hydra. Jaedong wants to buy more time. He wants to get out enough Roaches to defend this attack. Hydra, on the other hand, he wants to get damage done now. He wants to put the pressure on Jaedong. He wants to punish him for that faster third base, punish him for building more drones.
Reinforcement point is something that's very big in Zerg versus Zerg, as Jaedong will technically have the slight advantage in that, but because the gold base is there, it's obviously quite a big good for Hydra as well. Here come the Roaches now pushing on in. The numbers are pretty equal. Queens are going to try and help out this out as the reinforcement here to help out against Hydra. But Hydra has hit this little small timing where his Roaches were outnumbering for a moment. Can the reinforcements make the difference here for Jaedong? I'm not sure if they can. It's going to be very, very close here. But Hydra has been able to retain quite a lot of his Roaches, pulling the ones down to the bottom back there and really bringing on the pressure against Jaedong, hitting a fantastic little window. 60 Roaches against 4. There's very little left here for Jaedong. If Hydra sticks around, he might be able to kill off the rest.
Oh, such a good timing, doing absolutely devastating damage. This attack has been beautiful for Hydra. The Zerglings coming in now, desperation Zerglings, as the gas is so low for Jaedong. He manages to hang on. He is still ahead in drones by about 8 workers, but with that gold base kicking in, Hydra is actually mining almost as many minerals as he is.
Well, there's been many times where we've seen aggressive moves like that from players here in the World Championship Series, and it has been kind of a do-or-die moment for them. Are they going to break them with this kind of attack? Are they going to be able to finish the game here? But for Hydra, he plays it so smart. He plays with this gold base. He has a great economical advantage to the point where even if he goes toe-to-toe with that fight, he's still in a great position because he has the gold base. It's a beautiful move here that gives Hydra longevity in his games.
And just the trade, I think it was so great how he kind of fainted towards the back rocks. Jaedong pulled back and Hydra got a good position there. And now that he's controlling the middle of the map, he has this Roach superiority. Look at this. He can now actually take down the back rocks to Jaedong's base. And if Jaedong pulls into his main to defend, Hydra can once again rush back to out the left-hand side. Look at it. He's fainted to the right. Jaedong's up there and the Roaches are moving to the left.
Link's going to go for the counterattack here. Jaedong trying to buy himself some time. He knows that there is a potential. It could be a little bit behind in this regard, as the Lynx will get maybe onto a few of these drones, but the cleanup here from Hydra is good. He got a queen. He will limit some of that production, but Hydra, while all that was going on, bought himself a beautiful window. Plus two just finished because he contaminated Jaedong's plus two. If he could hit with this, this could be a winning move here in game number one.
Oh, he's pushing down that ramp. A very good concave for Jaedong.
And Hydra here is going to try and kill off as much as possible. Jaedong had the concave advantage, but plus two weapons could make a big difference here. Can the queens help on out? Reinforcements piling in here for Hydra very, very quickly. 30 Roaches against only 14 left here on the field. The plus two is doing so much. Look how close plus two is to finishing for Jaedong, but it's not enough. Hydra hit that timing with precision, with beautiful maneuvering here, and all in all, he is absolutely crushing this frontal force.
What a
GG. Oh. Game number one goes to Hydra. Very well played out. With all of those steps there that he had, really, really well done, Pig.
What commanding play from Hydra there. I felt like Jaedong maybe had a really nice position. He had the faster third, he had the mobility on the map. But Hydra just saying, I can do this attack and it's not all in because I've got that gold base behind it. And just these very simple feints with his Roaches to pull Jaedong out of position. That contaminate, as you said, it's just beautiful to have that 40, 50 second window. And then it's so sad if you're in Jaedong's shoes to see your plus two kick in and you've got 4, 5 Roaches left on the map. You've missed out on that opportunity for those upgrades to work.
Here is the final engagement again. You said at the beginning of this engagement, great concave for Jaedong, and indeed it is. But when numbers like the plus two are a factor, very difficult for him to win out against that, even, you know, just the overwhelming amount of Roaches Hydra had. And there's a lot of players in the World Championship Series that play the StarCraft. They play StarCraft, okay? They go up against an opponent and they just, you know, do the standard builds, the standard timings, the standard play. Hydra is an opportunistic player. He doesn't play StarCraft, he plays his version of StarCraft. Finding those holes to open up windows like the Contaminate onto the +2 weapons when it is level pegging completely with your opponent. If he plays a normal game of StarCraft, they finish at the same time, and then it continues on for there. You go on for another 15 minutes. If you're Hydra, you seize that window, you open it for yourself, and you put yourself in a great spot to just clinch the game right there. Brilliant stuff.
And of course, moving here onto Echo for map 2. Interestingly, this map is very good for a defensive play, very good for rushing up to roaches, something we've seen a lot in this tournament. It's very strong and popular in the current Zerg vs Zerg metagame. Let's talk about that in relation to what these players did last game. Jaedong opened up very safely, wanting map control. He built a Baneling nest, he built Zergling speed. Hydra, on the other hand, from the very beginning said, I'm not worried, I'm just gonna build extra queens, I'm gonna build a spine crawler, I'm gonna play a defensive focus, I just wanna get to roaches. Jaedong looked like he was maybe a little bit more worried about what Hydra could throw at him.
Well, we are gonna get into it now, ladies and gents. Game number 2. At the moment, that man on screen is looking good. Some trickery afoot, some little extra creepy plays going on at the very end of that Zerg versus Zerg, but he was victorious. Let's get into game number 2, as we have spawning down to the bottom right-hand corner. It is our blue Zerg. It is EG Jaedong. And up to the top left, we have one of the most fearsome opponents here in the World Championship Series. Representing Team Roots, it is Hydra!
Going into this map, both players know this is a very important one in a best of 5 series. If Hydra can take a quick 2-0 lead, he's going to feel very, very confident. And especially in a matchup like Zerg vs Zerg, where it can be a really, really good boon to take a couple of risks, to be able to throw out those more wild builds. If you've got a couple of extra lives, then you can do that without feeling encumbered, without feeling afraid.
And Jaedong going up against Hydra. I've got to ask you, Pig, here, you being a Zerg expert yourself, all the way from down in the corner of the planet where all the Zergs were bred, or most of them, how do you go up against someone like Hydra? Hydra, he seems to be covering all of his bases very well. He seems to have really, really strong mid-game presence. What do you do against someone like Hydra?
Oh, you know, it's such a complicated question. When you're going up against a rock, how do you fight it? I don't know. Do you wear it down slowly over time?
Yeah.
You've got to have a lot of really good tools at your disposal. You've got to have crisp, well-planned builds. And potentially there is a window to take advantage of the fact that Hydra tends to skip out on that early game aggression in terms of the Zergling speed, as we saw last game. Potentially, Jaedong could do something like a rush towards Mutalisks this game.
Okay.
Maybe getting up that mobility, taking a few economic steps to stretch his lead in the early game, take advantage of what he knows about Hydra's playstyle, whereas Hydra seems maybe a little bit too focused potentially on just getting to that roach stage. Maybe something like that is where Jaedong's focus will be.
And then if we think about how things stand currently in the rankings, Hydra obviously has banked huge amounts of points already here in 2015. He is propelling himself forwards, and whilst he would love more points, I think he's looking at the clear goal of first place here in this tournament because of the glory, more so than the points here. On the other side though, Jaedong, if you were in Jaedong's shoes here in the World Championship Series and having missed out on a season, having to almost push yourself to the grand finals to get enough points to keep your BlizzCon and global finals hopes alive. How do you go up against Hydra? How do you keep your composure here against him?
Oh, it's got to be very tricky. And look at this right now. We are seeing a dance. You know, if you lose an early overhaul, that could definitely mess with your composure. A very tricky Spore Crawler built here for Hydra.
Luring him in.
Jaedong taking no risks. His overlord doesn't dip into that main base, and it just skims around the edge. So this Spore Crawler, it has remained hidden from vision, and it's now just waiting for an opportunity. But that is a bit of a wasted investment for Hydra. He's got to be kicking himself a little bit that he didn't get the chance to shut down that overlord.
It is a bit of a shame there. Good that you found that whilst I was asking you another complicated question, Pig. but for now, we'll continue on here as Jaedong just getting himself that speed up and running. The Spore Crawler really doesn't do much at the front for a while. You can actually use it later on to detect things like detect things like burrow roaches and stuff, but Jaedong poking up here, seeing that spore crawler, he's like, aha! All right then, all right, I see what you were trying to do, and that's obviously a little bit of a waste.
And it gets in there, and it even sees no Zergling speed started on that spawning pool. Hydra clicking it a second too late, and looking like he may actually stick with it, may actually keep that up. But what Jaedong knows right now is that he's going for a roach base play. He has no units out, no Zergling speed, so what is Jaedong's path? It is to mass Zerglings right now. We have a big swell of 26 Zerglings coming out, and a Roach Warren dropping behind it, looking like he wants to flood Zerglings in here, and Hydra sees it coming. Is he going to be able to hold off with the wall?
Queen's going to have to plug that hole very, very quickly, and he's actually going to throw down another building, a double evolution chamber, as well as Roach Warren wall here for Hydra to make sure that those Zerglings aren't going to get through. Also, this helps a lot because he's not leaving those Queens vulnerable as part of the wall to just be broken on through. They can keep doing this damage, but at the same time now, that evolution chamber is slowly dwindling in health. If he's able to break on through, the Zerglings are about to pop at just the right time. That Queen, is it going to be able to block this hole with the Spore? I think it is, and Jaedong has to back off despite doing that. That was a good hold there from Hydra.
A really nice hold, and with his own Zergling speed about to finish, Hydra is going to be able to get back on the map, push back those Zerglings.
Oh.
But interestingly enough, this was not just a pressure. It was a pressure into a Roach Zergling all-in attack. Jaedong is on a very low economy right now.
I love it. The 1-2 punch, and he's really not expecting the second of those. As, it, of course, eventually the Overlords might be able to spot this heading over, but that's going to be so many roaches. He doesn't know about it just yet, and as those come into vision of the Overlords here, the Zerglings moving out. Now he sees the roaches at the front here with the Overlords. The roaches are going to be moving forward. Hydra realizes that a little bit of trouble could be awry. The Zerglings are still around. They're going to get themselves a queen. Any unit you can get with these Zerglings is going to be a good start, but once they couple on up, it's going to be difficult here for Hydra to hold.
It is, but there is so many units out. It was such a clean defense against those early Zerglings that there are just so many Lings out, and now with Roaches and plus one on the way, this is going to be so hard for Jaedong to break up this ramp. He needs to get in there quick before those Roaches build numbers, but with so many Zerglings threatening to flank and surround him.
Exactly. They're buying time here just a little bit. Jaedong knows he's against the clock. That's why he's pushing so aggressively up towards the natural base. He's coming in for the reinforcements here. Is Hydra still buying time? His Roach numbers are amassing behind this. His plus one weapons is on the way as well. I don't think he'll buy time for plus one weapons alone, but as long as he has roaches, I think he might be okay. Gonna actually try and build the wall once again here.
Every second that ticks by, Hydra is in a stronger position. Jaedong is on a timer, and look at this, Hydra even counter-attacking into the natural.
And the drones come off the line here as well, as Hydra has to try and deal with this. He knows that there was probably going to be quite a bit of damage done to him, but if he's able to hold on, he might be in a good spot here. He's losing a little bit of mining, and actually, that's actually going to get killed off an overlord. There's that spore crawler. He's going to clean this up. Hydra, he lost 10 workers, but at the same time, these links on the other side are trying to do some damage to the drones as well, and he might be susceptible to a counter-attack here. There are still a few roaches left over for Hydra.
Oh, a good number of drones died, but Jaedong was on such a low economy during all of that that he is now in a very hard position.
GG, there you go. Hydra takes game number two, holds on. You pointed it out just at the very end there. He was on a low economy, and also coupled up with the fact that those Lings went for the counterattack to get on top of the drones that remained. There was no way he was going to have the units available to deal with the counterattack of the roaches that lingered. That was, once again, a very strong showing there by Hydra.
An odd choice of build from Jaedong that game, going for that Ling Flood pressure. I think that needed to do a bit more damage than it did.
Yeah.
And the reason it's an odd choice on Echo is that ramp is so tight. But you can also think, because it's so easy to defend, maybe he chose to do this thinking he's gonna catch Hydra unawares. But Hydra took no chances. He immediately didn't underestimate it, put down that evolution chamber wall, and even added a second layer behind it. It was just such careful preparation from Hydra that it just shut down the Zergling pressure, and from there he did everything right. Hydra's execution was crisp, he scouted very well, bought time with his Zerglings. It was the perfect defense.
And here comes the second attack as well, as Hydra, it can take a great mind to say, I'm going to have enough defense at home, I'm going to send these Lings across, commit some of my force to the counter, and just see what I can get done. So really min-maxing every single little aspect of this game is Hydra. And now you've got to wonder, what is going through the mind of the Tyrant? What is going through the mind of Jaedong? Because a top 8 finish for him here in season number 2 to gather the points, to keep his global finals hopes alive, it's not cutting it, Pig. It's not cutting it. Hydra, as fearsome as opponent he is, he's proving that here against Jaedong. And Jaedong is one game away from being eliminated completely.
Oh, it's a dangerous, dangerous point. To be down two games so quickly, it's not only a dent in his career if he loses here, but his confidence is gotta be feeling a little bit frail right now. Jaedong took the risk there, but will it pay off?
Let's find out. Game number three, Toronto, as we get into it in the Zerg versus Zerg. Up to the top left, it is our red Zerg. It is Root Hydra. And of course, this could be his last game here in the World Championship Series. Representing Evil Genius in the blue, it is Jaedong.
Jaedong closing his eyes for a moment there, looking like he's really trying to find his center of focus.
Oh my god.
A 10 pool, Kalaris. This is a very, very big investment here.
In the face of complete adversity, at the very last straw, Jaedong, in his elimination game, chooses to go for one of the most aggressive strategies you possibly can here in the current meta of Zerg versus Zerg. Going back to that killer instinct, looking to really throw his opponents off guard. Jaedong here, risking it all.
Jaedong, throughout his entire Brood War history, has always spoken about the need to have bluff. The ability to gamble, the ability to take chances in StarCraft as an integral part of being a champion. And that is exactly what we are seeing right now. Hydra is going for the hatchery first. This is exactly what Jaedong wants. Jaedong is starting up a queen. What we're seeing here is a 10 pool into a fast Zergling speed. He's going to bank up a lot of Zerglings, and they're going to flood across the map. He's going to have a tiny economy behind this. This is a one punch that needs to knock Hydra out of this game.
Yeah, he needs to keep himself alive at the moment. And one thing that is nice for Hydra that he did send that Overlord to in the correct direction, but I don't know if it even gets to the ramp in time to be able to spot these Zerglings coming out. It's trying desperately. It's going to be very, very close. He's banking up the Zerglings. He's actually... He's going to spot this as they're coming out, but at the same time... This is such a weird dynamic here, Pig.
This is a four-player map. Now, Jaedong choosing this build, he was hoping for that this would not happen. This was the 1-in-3 chance that Hydra's first Overlord would scout in his direction. And that Overlord of Hydra, it spotted Jadong's Overlord coming out at a really odd timing. As a player of Hydra's level, he knows that is an odd Overlord. He's already got his suspicions building up inside him. His hackles are rising. He sees no natural expansion. He knows there is something coming his way. And look at this. His spawning pool finishes immediately. Spawning pool starting, Zergling starting, Queen starting. This is going to be so difficult for Jaedong to break. And Jaedong, he's still pulling up the Zerglings. What choice does he have?
Hydra with the reeds. And now every single pair of Zerglings Jaedong makes it slowly puts him in that commitment. Of course he is there. Hydra sees no base. As long as he's able to hold this with a little, not too much damage been done, he should be okay. But now he's got to think to himself, okay, one spine crawler. It's about to be finished, but he still hasn't moved out with these Zerglings. Do I need another spine crawler? How many links am I going to have with this? It's going to be speed probably hitting me with it. And the Overlord is actually being evaded, but it moves into position to try and spot those Zerglings. He can't escape from it. He reveals them. Jaedong, he's revealed his hand completely now. Speed has been seen here as well for Hydra. How is he going to buckle down? Bringing his queens to the ramp, making sure they can't get up. This can buy him quite a bit of time.
Last season's runner-up here. He's taking his breath slowly, setting up his defenses. He's walling off his ramp here with his queens. All of his units are getting in position, but this is an absolute flood of Zerglings from Jaedong.
I don't even know if it's going to be enough here at all. I don't think it's going to be able to break this ramp at all. These two queens are being able to hold on the fort. The Spinecrawler's going to take a bit of damage here, and Jaedong still has the milling numbers. He's been able to kill off one of the queens. He gets the Spinecrawler. He gets the second queen as well. He's killed off some of the links. He's going to try and go for the wraparound on the next queen. Links are in production here by Hydra. He needs to get them out. He still doesn't have Zergling speed. That's a huge advantage that we're seeing here from Jaedong. As links flood down from the high ground here for Hydra, he has a supply advantage. The army numbers are very, very close. The links, the slow links, are not doing too badly against this. Another queen needs to get into the fray to help on out, but here come more links.
Jaedong is getting a lot of damage done here, but the time is running out of the hourglass right now. The Zergling speed is dangerously close to finishing for Hydra. Jaedong needs to get damage done right now, and it looks like he will.
He kills off the links, he kills off the queen once again. He's on towards the Spinecrawler. The links are going to be the next fight, and the Spinecrawler has been cancelled here. Jaedong is going to be able to do quite a bit more damage. He needs to get even more done, though. Going to stick around at this natural, wait for those links to pop out to fight and conquer.
He is fighting for his tournament life right now, and it looks like he might just barely be able to make this happen. The Zergling speed has kicked in for Hydra, though, ooh, but he just does not have the same number of Zerglings. However, he's going to pull back. Jaedong pushing in.
He needs a good position here to fight against this. He needs a good position. Now, what are the link numbers at the moment here on the field? It's difficult to tell because some more reinforcements are on the way here. Going to have to use the drones to fight. It's still 15 workers to 10. So the longer this goes on, obviously Jaedong doesn't have the benefit of double hatchery production, but he was trying to nibble away at that hatchery, at the natural, just to make sure he can limit some of that.
Oh, he still has such a good Zergling lead. Jaedong is just being so pristine with his choice of engagements. He's only fighting when he has a good position, when he has more Zerglings, and Hydra's losing these Zerglings as they're popping out, a few at a time, a few at a time. Jaedong is taking his edges, and the drones are coming down from the main base. Hydra is pulling everything.
There you go, GG. Jaedong with the plays here in game number 3. It was spotted early, but the tactician in Jaedong is able to win out there. Hydra, having spotted that so early and having tried to prepare for it, he's got to be kicking himself. One spine crawler going up against that, it's quite the ambitious move.
We've all been in that position as Zerg players where you think, I think I can hold. I've got queens on my rib. Yeah. I've got spine crawlers. But then I think Hydra saw victory in his sights. The 3-0, he thought, I've got this. I'm comfortable. But not dropping an extra spine crawler, not getting extra queens started early enough, even adding drones after he saw no natural expansion from Jaedong, just pushing his economy that little bit too much. And Jaedong, with such pristine Zergling control, when he flooded in there, he just took good fight after good fight and used his numbers perfectly.
I was worried that this first engagement wasn't going to go well for Jaedong, but he proved me otherwise, definitely. Killing off these queens, trying to transfuse there between them wasn't quite enough here to hold this off. And this was the beginning of the end. Being able to prioritize your targets at this point for Jaedong is of the utmost importance here. And with all of these Lings not having speed as well, the engagements he can get are far more favorable for him going on later.
Just beautiful repositioning from Jaedong. Masterful play. A lesser player would not have been able to pull that off with that double hatchery production flooding out.
Very, very well done. He keeps his hopes alive in the round of 8 at the moment, does Jaedong, with an aggressive build. And now we will be moving on to our next game, game number 4. Hydra. He's been in a lot of positions where he's able to clinch almost that rubber match situation, but he doesn't want to crumble. He does not want to crumble here in the round of 8. As we get into game number 4, to the bottom right-hand corner, it in the red, it is our Root Gaming player, it is Hydra! And up to the top left, we have our blue Zerg, keeping himself alive for you guys and for him. It is EG Jaedong!
A sigh of relief must be coming out of Jaedong after that game. To win from that situation, seeing that Overlord desperately trying to avoid it, but not being able to, he must have had a sinking feeling in his stomach. But Jaedong is such a fierce, steely competitor. He keeps it together, he executes perfectly, and he wins the unwinnable.
Yeah, you hit the nail right on the head. Just being able to stay calm in the face of adversity does Jaedong. He's been there a lot in the past. He's probably the most well-versed player here. Hydra actually probably being the second one if you consider their Brood War background. So really quite the clash of Zergs here in the round of 8. Both of them looking for points, looking for the glory moving on forward here in the World Championship Series. For Jaedong, it means a huge amount because he did miss Season 1, because he needs to claim the points here in Season 2. And what an opponent to get in your first round in the playoffs in Hydra, who came second last season, is looking for a first place and nothing else here in this particular season after being so close to grasping the trophy in Season 1, being one game away and being fought all the way back through those last games.
It takes a lot of confidence, a lot of knowledge of your abilities as a player, and a lot of steely calm. And that's what we're seeing from Jaedong here. Playing Zerg versus Zerg the way he loves to, he is taking risks, taking advantages, throwing his opponent off with two very aggressive builds, even though only one of them succeeded, now going into the most greedy opening, going for a hatchery, and then a very fast gas before sporting pool. He's gonna rush up to his Zergling speed. Hydra, on the other side of things, playing a little bit more conservative. conservative with his builds now. After seeing the crazy aggression Jaedong's throwing at him, going for an early spawning pool, a very conservative gas timing, and taking the slow route towards that mid game.
And I wonder if we see Jaedong seize the initiative again, because I feel that going onto the later stages, Hydra is a menace. He is an absolute menace in this matchup. Dealing with him later on, when he will not miss a beat, can be tough. So Jaedong has got to look for the answer once again here in the round of 8. And for now, he's going to be getting himself speed out pretty quickly. Hydra can potentially catch up very, very soon as he's about to hit 100 gas, but doesn't quite have the minerals for it, because he obviously wants to relieve himself of being supply blocked with that overlord they just started.
And of course, looking at how Hydra's played the last couple of games, might not even opt for that Zergling speed. Often shows the gas, says, hey, there's an option of me doing this.
True.
But sometimes just goes straight for that lair, that fast roach play. Interestingly enough, Jaedong, even though he didn't scout Hydra's base with his overlord because there was a fast queen deflecting that scout, didn't even build Zerglings to scout. Does not care. He feels like he has a read on Hydra right now. Jaedong feels, there's nothing you're going to do to punish me. I can play greedy. And look at this, going straight into a fast evolution chamber and a plus one melee build. What a unique build coming out of Jaedong.
Yeah, this is interesting. It comes back to what we were saying before, actually, of like, does Jaedong try and seize the initiative? This is one of those builds that tries to seize the initiative. But if they can't deny the scouting, though, that could get a little bit problematic. Oh. Ling is going to run on around, and you can't cancel a completed evolution chamber. So, Jaedong, you have been spotted. You've been rumbled.
The hand has been shown, and Jaedong on the other side of things also trying to sneak in to get a scout. Doesn't see too much, but does see the Roach Warren at the front, as well as extra queens. He can tell. Hydra, he's doing what Hydra loves most. He's going to lair, he's going to get a Roach Warren. However, Hydra has started a late Zergling speed this game, so maybe he's changing things up.
Does the plus one weapons here in Jaedong's hands, obviously with an evolution chamber being spotted at the back, Hydra may have suspected something aggressive, but taking an earlier third here as a backup strategy, does plus one weapons help that a lot?
It's definitely going to give Jaedong a strength in those Zergling wars.
Yeah.
Those Zerglings are going to shred his opponent's Zerglings. However, he hasn't started Zergling production yet because Hydra's tricked him. Hydra's showed two evolution chambers, a Roach Warren at the front, but he's not using them. They're a fake. Rather than investing in that, he's got that Zergling speed and he's got a flood of Zerglings coming out. And Jaedong doesn't look like he's going to be ready for it. He needs to see this coming as soon as possible or these Zerglings are going to be able to cancel his third base.
Oh, he knew that was going to be spotted there by the Zerglings. The queen moved out to the front, maybe to kill off an overlord if it was close by, but Zergling speed is now finished. Needs to start his Zergling production as well. He started 12 at the moment, but this is like 20-some Zerglings here for Hydra that are going to be plowing forward towards the natural, actually. He's going straight for the jugular. The queens are trying to try and block off. They managed to block off quite a bit of it, but there is a wraparound on that first queen there. If he's able to take that down, it might open the floodgates here. The drones come off the line. Hydra's going to back one out. He's going to go for guaranteed damage over at the third base here to try and kind of consolidate his losses.
Oh, all three of those queens surviving. Jaedong, remember, he has the plus one melee upgrade here, and he is actually going to save that third base. Oh, a brush with danger, but Jaedong is now in a commanding position, getting that Zergling flood out. He has full map control. Very difficult for Hydra to contest the map right now.
Looking to threaten over the other side of the map here. Lots of Lings in production. Hydra kind of anticipating that he will lose himself a queen, but he has roaches in backup to support these Lings. Getting the troops back home, nursing them, making sure they are okay here, and he technically has an army advantage, so Jaedong doesn't want to push too far.
We're actually seeing a special build out of Hydra right now. Jaedong, he's committing to a fight, but he is actually getting killed by these roaches. Oh, a little bit of a misstep there. What he does not realize is right now Hydra is doing the Hydra special, skipping upgrade, skipping lair. He's got almost 20 slow roaches out here and a flood of Zerglings behind this. There is no tech behind this. He took the third base, but it was a fake.
He is investing
in an all-in huge roach attack. He's going for the jugular. He wants to kill Jaedong right now.
This is it. This is if this works for Hydra, he kills off lots of extra Zerglings as well. If this works for Hydra, he will be going to the round of 4. And what a build it is, not having Gleary Constitution. If this does not work correctly, then it is all over for him in game number 4. But it could be all over for Jaedong as the fight goes down. That's so many roaches, so much firepower. Jaedong is going to have to scramble for some kind of defense here as Hydra really battering down the doors now. 48 army supply against 36. I don't think there's enough here for Jaedong as Hydra is going to continually press on. He kills off queens. He kills off roaches. It's 40 roaches against 8. If he reinforces with Zerglings, then this is gonna be completely done. Jaedong pulls the drones off the line. He knows he's in trouble at this point. A lot go down here in the natural. The portable weapons is approaching, but it's not gonna be enough.
What a surprising timing out of Hydra, just saying, get out. I am gonna win this series. You cannot take control of this. And this overwhelming, surprising roach push is doing huge damage.
Jaedong can't come to terms with it. All of these roaches are very, very low, and it's gonna take a miracle for him to clean it all up with the extra reinforcements, even the drones coming to fight for Hydra. But there you go, GG. Hydra moves on to the round of four with absolute brilliant presence here in Zerg versus Zerg. He defeats Jaedong in the round of eight, destroying some of his chances at moving forward to the global final. But Hydra is on the hunt. He is on the hunt to the round of four. He is on the hunt for first place.
The tournament doesn't really begin until you're in the top four for Hydra. That's where his eyes are focused. And that just showed commanding play there to take out someone as strong as Jaedong in his strongest matchup, Zerg versus Zerg. Beautiful play from Hydra.
Well done by Hydra. Let's head over to the main stage with Chobra to hear how he feels about moving on to the round of four.
And yes, indeed, on the bottom side of the bracket, first up, we do have Hydra going on to the semifinals. Hydra, you're coming back into the season. Crowd cheering for you. We talked about it in the round of 16. You want to get that revenge. You want to say, I could have gotten it in season one. I want it this season. You're one step closer. How do you feel?
Yeah, this quarterfinal was going to be the hardest moment in the WCS. But yeah, I won the Jaedong, so yeah, I got confidence, so many confidence against Bolt as well. So yeah, I'm excited.
All right, taking down Jaedong, saying this was going to be my hardest matchup. And yeah, it looked like you were going to get that 3-0, but then map number three, Jaedong puts a little bit of a twist in it, puts a break on your movement. Were you just like, it's just one map, I can still win map four? Or did that worry you a little bit?
Yeah, I thought I was gonna win that game, but I think my mistake was, yeah, maybe block overall. Yeah.
All right, well, Hydra, like you said, you're confident against whoever comes up, especially Polt. And if you are able to move on to the finals, no matter who comes up from the upper bracket, do you think this trophy is going to be yours?
Yeah. This semifinal is gonna be the final.
Oh, this semifinal is gonna be the final, seeing that whoever wins this one is gonna go on to take the trophy. Well, another big congratulations to Root Gaming's Hydra for moving on to the semifinals this weekend.
Another top four finish for Hydra, who eliminates Jaedong here in the quarterfinals, one step closer to another final. He's looking closer and closer towards a fourth final of 2015. Very impressive performances from Hydralith, joined by In Control and Roddy,
number one.
The number one Twitch streamer for StarCraft 2 over here, Rotterdam08. Good to have you on the desk, Kev.
You guys are terrible.
Why? We're just happy to have you, Kev. It's not often we get to have the number one Twitch streamer.
Moving
of StarCraft
on,
2.
Sean. We're moving on.
3-1 by Hydra. A lot of people expected Hydra to come through and to be able to win this, and he did what everyone thought he could.
He continues to dominate. You know, as a huge Jaedong fan, I would love if that series, if I could say anything else about that series, but it wasn't. Even the game that Jaedong, I feel like, pretty much stole it from underneath. Hydra was really fun and cool and amazing micro, but I think that was Hydra's game to lose, basically. If he snaps up the defense a little bit better, it's a clean 3-0, and it's not even close.
What are your thoughts with it?
I absolutely agree with that. Jaedong definitely taking huge risk in the game that he did won, but then game number four, I really felt that was kind of the game where Jaedong could have made the difference. Things were looking well for him. I felt his build was working out, and I mean, ZvZ is a very unforgiving matchup, right? If you make one big mistake, you will end up on the losing side. And Jaedong, he was up 10 workers, he had a quicker third base, he had +1 missile attacks on the way, he just took a fight with Zerglings on the other side of the map. he didn't have to take it all. He's fighting Lynx and Roaches with just Lynx. If those Lynx just go home and then he makes a couple Roaches on his own, I think if Jaedong defends that attack, he's in a phenomenal position. Suddenly you're looking at game five and everything is different. But I mean, Hydra is extremely solid, especially the first two games. I really think that's just Hydra in a nutshell at the moment.
Well, Jaedong has to perform for the rest of the year now. There's no other way if he wants to play at the global finals. But let's take a look at the bracket as Hydra has gone through to the quarterfinals and is already anticipating the next semi to be pulled. He already thinks that that's what's going to happen. But is it? Is the big question now, because TLO has already defeated him once in the round of 32, and he has another chance to beat him again on the biggest stage where it matters the most. Pult versus TLO, Roddy.
I mean, I think Hydra just said that the semi-final was going to be basically the final, but he didn't say Pult specifically, so maybe he just knows about Dario ZvZ.
Maybe he's worried about that Zerg versus Zerg. But either way, Hydra just looking at that final, really looking at it. But it's not going to be easy, I don't think. I think we've got some very good and talented European players at the top half of that bracket as well.
I mean, Bonnie has defeated Hydra a couple times. In the most recent encounter, Bonnie actually won against Hydra. Now, it wasn't the biggest match of all time.
Most recent other than day one, but yes.
Thank you, Jeff.
Where Hydra demolish him.
Yeah. That's why Jeff's here.
But I mean, how often do we see that, you know, where somebody sneaks in easy, you know, a victory in round of 16? It could be different. Yeah. But yeah, before this WCS, I mean, it's not impossible for Bonnie to win against Hydra. Of course, Hydra looked great when they did play earlier this weekend. But it is not impossible. We have seen it before. And let's not forget Liu Bao. Maybe if Liu Bao makes it past Bonnie, Liu Bao did defeat Hydra.
That's what you're here for.
And I, yeah, I mean, if we're getting ahead of ourselves a little bit, let's say Lobo does beat Bunny. He is not a slouch for either of those guys. If Pult beats, we're getting way ahead of ourselves. If it is Pult Hydra, either one of those two, Lilbo stands opposition if he gets there. I mean, I'm excited. There's great matches in between.
Until we get that far into the tournament, guys, we do have one more quarterfinal. The German TLO attempts a shot at the champion for the second time this season. Can he do it two times in one season?